Now, this next session, I am super excited to announce and bring in. I will shortly pass over to Gill, but this session is around tipping points and all the multiple social tipping points that we can see and need to generate in order to move to quickly to climate solutions. So, Gill Einhorn, I'm going to pass to you. You're so welcome. I'll allow you to welcome all the panelists. Over to you.
Thanks very much, Lucy, and welcome everyone. I'd like us to start by taking a moment. And if you feel comfortable, you can close your eyes. Take a deep breath. And as you breathe out, let all of the craziness of Neo Climate Week drop away. We're present here together. Imagine yourself sitting at a lake. It's perfectly calm and peaceful, and it's a perfect circle. Like a mirror, that lake reflects the sky, and you can see the clouds in the lake. You notice the mountains and the forests. You look up from the surface and you see people sitting like you around the lake, each of them holding a pebble. And you look down into your own hand and you're holding a pebble too. So with a smile, you take your pebble and you throw it into the perfect center of the circle and watch as it reverberates out to the shores. And as all the people sitting around with you see the ripples coming towards them, they notice their stones too. And they start to skip their stones into the lake. Watch the ripples. See how they interact. And suddenly, as though the heavens have opened, you see the rivers, the ripples turning into a river, which emerges, and the sounds become deafening around you. So many ripples, so much water, all flowing together in the same direction. So let's breathe in that river. And if you've had your eyes closed, feel free to open them now. Welcome to the river of positive tipping points. Our pebbles are the actions. The ripples are the impact of those actions. And the river, which is not possible without the pebbles and the action, is the positive tipping points that we can collectively trigger if we do it in harmony and in synchronicity and in alignment with each other. You may be hearing some sounds. These are from the Colombia's misty cloud forests. And they come from an artistic collective called Vostera. The cloud forest is bordered by a huge stone that creates reverberation of the sounds of the forest in the forest as you are there, in the Chicaque National Park. They sound right, not just because these sounds are actual sounds of the landscape, but because these sounds are also funding the landscape. All of the rights from these sounds go back into protecting and conserving these forests. This is the Sounds Rights Initiative that the Earth to Science community is supporting. And the spirit of that is for us to ensure with our little pebbles, the choices we make on Spotify, that we're able to create waves of change in the landscapes that are threatened today. Today we're going to be exploring how we can align our actions, and how each of us can play our part in that river. And we're going to be co-curating questions for this panel. So if you'd like to, you can take your phone out. You can go to slido.com, S-L-I-D-O.com, and you can go to the hashtag positive tipping points. There's also a QR code for those who would like to use that. And I'd encourage you to ask your best possible questions, but also to upvote and downvote the questions that you're seeing, because we'll then find the best questions to ask this wonderful panel today. So without further ado, it's my privilege to welcome Professor Tim Lenton, the director of the Global Systems Institute at the University of Exeter. He is not only a pioneering scientist, but he is also the father of Earth system tipping points and their corollary, the positive tipping points. So Tim, can you explain to the audience what a positive tipping point is and where we are on that agenda today?
Sure thing, Jill. You can always, if you're feeling brave, lean back on your chair just to remind yourself what a tipping point is. I think we all know that you can get in some systems to a point where a small change or small nudge one way or the other determines whether you end up flat on your back on the floor or back upright. That doesn't seem like a good tipping point, did it? But we're here to talk about the positive tipping points. I love the fact that, what's he or she called? I wasn't paying attention. Yeah. So I'm doing something slightly different in the slides, but it's a bit like I was soaring slowly the back legs of the chair in this case. There's a system with two different states, and it's in the one on the left, the ball rolling around. But we're doing something to the system that's making it the incumbent way of doing things less and less stable. And for today, the incumbent way of doing things is still burning fossil fuels, eating a lot of red meat, and trashing our life support system. But what we need to do is tip into a very different state of the economy, possibly our worldviews, and many aspects of our societies. And whenever you have a tipping point in a system, it's because two things are going on. Maybe you've done some work to weaken the damping feedbacks that were maintaining the old status quo, all those fossil fuel subsidies, all those lobbyists for the meat industry or whatever. But you're also working with the reinforcing or amplifying feedbacks within society to try and engender a self-propelling change. And what do I mean by those amplifying feedbacks at the tipping point? We're talking about the fact that we learn from each other and our ideas and behaviors spread through what scientists call social contagion. We're talking about the fact that the more we do something or the more we make something, the better we generally get at doing it or making it. We call that learning by doing. And also if we're making stuff, and we're gonna have to make a load of new stuff to get to a sustainable future, the more we make of something like solar panels or batteries, generally the cheaper the next unit gets to make. And these are all powerful reinforcing feedbacks that together can get strong enough to give us what we need, which was conceptually we're trying to get out of unsustainable state of society into sustainable state through some deliberate collective action. And as Jill's already hinted, if we coordinate our different actions from our different perspectives, we can be more effective in shallowing the valley, if you like, that we started in and bringing the system to the point where we can tip it over. So I've been busy studying this stuff for a while and finding the stories out there of positive tipping points that have already happened. And if you trace it back, surprise, surprise, it's usually social activists that are at the heart of positive, what ultimately becomes a positive tipping point. So these are some fairly well-known social activists photographed in 1989 in Switzerland, actually, Jill, with a hobby-converted electric vehicle behind them. So members of the pop band A-ha and their architect friend Harold in the middle, who's crucial to the story. And they're at the same time making demand to the Norwegian government, you need to implement 9 policies that are going to incentivize the transitions to electric vehicles in Norway as part of a heading towards sustainability. And they leveraged the media, because they follow this world-famous pop band everywhere, to get that message out and to actually bring it to fruition. Now, it took 20 years of experimenting and learning by doing when we're in the brown area here, where the market for cars in Norway is still dominated by petrol and diesel cars. But there's experimentation going on, especially in the cities. People are some people are driving around in little EVs, they're learning from each other, people are realizing this is a great technology. And as soon as there's a tipping point, as you can see, a bit after 2010, when the first major manufacturers put electric vehicles on the market, bang, the system tips, and the market's completely tipped in Norway to a cleaner mode of transport. Now, globally, EVs are also on the exponential growth curve, and it's because the crucial technology inside them, the batteries, is getting cheaper. The more batteries you make, the cheaper they get, but also the better they get. They've got three times the range they had for the same massive battery, three times the range they had a decade ago now. This is pretty extraordinary learning, and it's strong enough, this feedback now, that we start to see a global tipping point to electrification of mobility. And we're not just talking about cars, we're talking about two and three wheelers in the global south, we're talking about startup companies in East Africa making electric motorbike taxis with swappable batteries. This is a great revelation in terms of increasing the efficiency of transport, taking away major source of air pollution, which is fossil fuel air pollution is still killing 5 million people every year. So this is positive. And it couples with another tipping point, which I'm trying to sketch here, which is even bigger, because a quarter of our greenhouse gas emissions are coming from just making electricity at the moment, the power sector. But by our estimation, we're actually just past the tipping point where renewable energy is going to come to dominate our power supply, in particular solar power. So these maps are just showing, because the more solar panels we've made, the cheaper they've got, as well as the better they've got, and they've been getting spectacularly cheaper. Well, they're now the cheapest source of power in most of the world, as you can kind of see in the 2023 sketch, and they're getting cheaper faster than anything else. So they're set to absolutely dominate future electricity, but they need to work with batteries so we can balance electricity supply and demand everywhere in the world. And a lot of those batteries are going to be batteries that have got cheaper and better because of the developments in the car and truck sectors. And in fact, some of them will be batteries that come as secondhand batteries out of those electric cars or three-wheelers or two-wheelers and go onto the grid. So the point there is there's coupling between these major sectors of the economy and our activities. Like, we need a power supply, but we also like to move around. So what we've been doing and released in a report yesterday was the very first time we've taken a state-of-the-art model and actually started quantifying the feedbacks that are reinforcing not just within sectors of this green, clean economy, but between them. So things like the fact that those batteries coming out of the car sector are going to go into the power sector and so forth. Well, there's a lot of detail. I'll let you read our report. I've got a few copies on a positive tipping point cascade in power, transport, and heating. But the short version is tipping one thing in one sector can not just benefit us there, but can bring forward tipping in another sector. And what we really wanted to answer was the question of what are the most powerful policies that policymakers can make, and that we, the citizens, or our businesses, can also support to bring forward these positive tipping points. And the answer is pretty straightforward. It's mandates. Mandates means things like, you're not going to be able to sell petrol and diesel cars in our market from 2035 onwards, or we're going to phase out coal power stations in the rich world at least by 2035. And then in the truck sector, we went for no diesel trucks after 2040. And in heating, all the heating, new heating supply you want has got to be heat pumps from 2035 onwards, and we ramp up to those targets. Those have the killer effect. Don't worry about all the colored grass. They're the thing that are more powerful than subsidies or taxes, which also have their own effects and can be useful. So that tells us very clearly the kind of leadership we're going to need from the top down, but crucially from the bottom up, us as citizens or as businesses, can give governance or political leaders the confidence to make the bold move they need to put these mandates in place, because you and I know they're going to be lobbied by the incumbents, lobbied, not to do it or to weaken it or whatever. Finally, just a taster, I think we're nearly out, Steve Smith, who might be in the room, and Gill and some of the team have been working really hard together with the University of Exeter team, the World Economic Forum, to start to condense this knowledge into an accessible form particularly for businesses, but for anyone who's interested, frankly, in what's called their strategic intelligence platform. And coming soon, probably at Davos or when it's released, will be this kind of funky online system where if you want to learn more about this opportunity space, the state of the science, the actions that are most effective, you're going to go into this online portal. You'll be able to pull out stuff on positive tipping points and nature-based solutions, which I hope we're going to get back to together, as well as for that renewable energy story and a bunch else. And it's going to let you drill down and generate your own little auto-magically created report on, okay, like, give me a briefing. How can I learn about this stuff? Give me some tools that is actionable knowledge so that we can all hopefully bring forward these positive tipping points together. So yeah, I'll leave it there. If you want to keep the conversation going, and we're hoping a lot of you will join us at a conference on this start of July next year. Thanks a lot.
Camila Camilo is the founder of the Creators Academy in Brazil. And she is creating her own waves of change and positive tipping to connect the local action on the ground with what's happening globally. So I'd love to find out from you, Camila, a little bit more about what you see the role of entrepreneurs and innovators in helping to propel these waves of positive tipping points.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. It's really an honor being here today. I think we have two points here. Entrepreneurs has the mission to be really disruptive and stop just the doing incremental innovation because they don't have the strings attached during the process. So I think this is our biggest change, but we cannot just innovate thinking about the exit of our companies and our organizations for like becoming the next billionaire. We actually need to make choices that leads to the second point, which is, are we doing things that is good for the planet and for the people? And it's for all people, for like which people we are benefit, right? So I think with these two aspects, entrepreneurs had a chance to actually change the game and show not just for the big business, but for the whole society, how can we do together?
Thanks, Camila. It's an interesting point about not just for the planet, but also for the people, because there is a question there related to inclusivity. And we have with us Jacob Johns, who is an indigenous person, and from the Akimel, Odam, and Hopi tribes here in the US. And you're working on rippling the wisdom of indigenous peoples into climate action and justice. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on Camila's point in terms of the inclusivity. What is the role of inclusivity in helping ensure these positive tipping points are actually positive for as many people as possible in the system?
Yeah, it's really nice to be on a space and share this space with you all and have this in-depth conversation. I'm a community supporter organizer, which means that I'm a solo nonprofit here in the US. And one of the projects that I lead is a Wisdom Keepers delegation, which is a collective of international indigenous wisdom keepers from around the world that can come together to condense their indigenous ancestral wisdom into contemporary climate policy that can be adapted by heads of state underneath the umbrella of the UNFCCC. You know, as a climate activist and somebody who organizes and works within environmental spaces, climbing up to the top level of our negotiating teams and working with NDCs and starting to see all the intricacies that work within the umbrella of the UNFCCC, we start to see how indigenous people are tokenized into these spaces, that the words that indigenous people bring into the conversation get used to supplement greenwashing as we walk more and more into this impending climate collapse. And it's depressing. You know, the science is always telling us that everything is screwed, that we've already gone past the tipping points that we can no longer step back from. And we are constantly inundated with this apocalyptic vision of the future. And I can say, as an indigenous person who lives and still lives in the US, that we have already reached an apocalypse. That time has already passed for us. Mm. We are already living in a post-apocalyptic world, and that we understand that this is the reality of life. We are living in a global world. We are living in a global community. And it's important for us to figure out what is possible? What can we do now? And more importantly, what does the ancestral wisdom that is given to us from our ancestors that we hold and carry within us as a moral and spiritual obligation in order to affect contemporary climate policy now? I know, it's kind of hard, right? It seems pretty simple, but it's actually very complicated. And I just, you know, I think the inclusivity part of it is really important because we have reached beyond these domestic perspectives.
Yep.
The time for small increment steps has passed us, and we must take a giant quantum leap into the future together. And we must utilize the voices and the wisdom from our people as humanity to take care of the planet, and more importantly, focus our minds on what kind of a future we're creating for our children.
Thanks, Jacob. Now, not in the future, now. And I'm going to turn to Solly Townsend in a moment because you mentioned the science is showing us we're screwed. And I'm very curious to hear Solly's perspective on that. Solly is a solutionist. She is also the brains behind this Solutions House and Futerra. So Solly, how do you respond to this? How does Futerra think about the solutions orientation?
Thank you. Well, first of all, apologies for being late to such an amazing panel. Public transport is fantastic, unless you get on the train going the wrong way and don't notice it. Ended up on 89th Street and going, I don't think that's where I'm supposed to be. So I got my steps in running back down. So thank you so very much. When we say the words tipping points, as we all know, we tend to think about the negative tipping points. The shocking, terrifying tipping points that can happen within our natural environment to push us towards points of no return. And of course, there's also social tipping points and cultural tipping points. And I think one of the problems with some of the tipping point language, and I think that was so well elucidated here, is that it's regarded as an end state once something's tipped, and that's it. And then, you know, you might as well shut up shop and go home. And I think that the idea that actually our lives, our cultures are going to face numerous radical changes throughout our life. Many of them will be bad, many of them will be good, many of them will be looked back on in generations to come as different to those who experience them. And let me give you a very facetious example. I'm 50 this year. Hooray! That's where you all say. 50? No! And I'm the same age as the internet. So in 1974 is when some of the basis of the internet. That has created such extraordinary change in so many people's lives. Absolutely fundamental change. I remember what it was like, or at least I'm supposed to remember what it was like before we had mobile phones in our pockets, etc. And when children in my family ask me, I'm like, I can't remember. I honestly can't remember how I organized my life. So I have lived through a radical, complete change in our financial system, in our consumption system, in how people get dates, in how people find their way around cities, in how we communicate to each other. I've seen the erosion of some parts of society, which were fantastic, and the blooming of other parts of society, which are also fantastic and wouldn't have lived there. Would we have been able to have a connection like this if we hadn't been able to organize it online? And so when people say to me that radical, swift change isn't possible, I want to laugh because you've literally lived through one. And my grandmother lived through another. So my grandmother wanted to be an entrepreneur, but she wasn't able to open a bank account. She wasn't able to have a home in her own name. She wasn't allowed to be a leader. She had to leave her job when she got pregnant because she was a woman. And she's still with us and she's alive. And her granddaughter owns her own company and is able to make her choices. So one of the things which I just want to bring to the idea of there being positive and cultural tipping points is that often the biggest problem with our ability to make those true isn't just the finances or the politics or the inbuilt cultural and structural inequalities. It's also a lack of imagination and our lack of our ability to go, do you know what? And I'm so sorry, but it's kind of funny when British people swear, but we fucking made all this up. We made up our economies, we made up our systems, we made up all of it, And so if we choose to, we can make it up in a different way. And if we bring some of that imagination, and I think one of the things which I'm most grateful to Indigenous and traditional cultures for, as well as the wisdom, is also the imagination. And that validation of the fact that everything doesn't all have to be sort of techno sort of boxes and all the rest of it. And considering we live in a world where AI is increasingly going to come for the heartless rational decision making. So heartless rational decision making is increasingly being taken over by AI, that actually our emotions and our heart and our ability to make gut decisions and human decisions is pretty much going to be the only valuable resource left that human beings get to do rather than AI. So I think the point around have we passed the scientific tipping points or not, is it worth us still working? I'm not enough of a scientist to know, although I'm incredibly impressed by what I just saw about some of those exponential curves. But I do know enough about storytelling to know that we can fundamentally change the story at a much faster pace than climate change. So we can change the story at a point degree of change very, very, very much faster. And so we want to stay well under 1.5 degrees of climate change, and we can get to 10 degrees of story change really quickly.
Yo-Yo Ma speaks a little bit about how you can actually bring about cultural change as the fastest evolutionary force. And I think that speaks very well to what you're referring to. And I think what I'd love to come to Camilla about now is, how do we help to bring those mindset shifts and those heart space changes? And what's our opportunity to propel the positive tipping points of culture through that?
Okay, first I want to say that I don't know a tip point that we just accept that digital technologies is all the technologies that we have. So technology is everything. Is the chair you are sitting on, is the backpack that you're carrying, is your phone, but it's also this building. So like digital technology is not 100% of our life. Today is a big part of that, but it's not like the 100%, right? So separate those things maybe can support us to recover the lack of imagination. And I believe that like what I've been trying to do is shift from trauma-based approach to what I call emotional-based approach. You know, from 100 years of psychology research, all that we studied was like trauma, right? We just talk about what go wrong and what the wrong do to us. The positive psychology is actually a pretty new science, like 30 years maybe, a little bit more than that maybe. And when we look to how we learn stuff, everything's about trauma, and we do that for climate and nature as well. So we show just the things that makes people has more fear and go to a fight, flight, freeze state. And when people are on those states, they will make bad decisions. You know, because when you are in the fight mode, you are like combative, like you're just full of rage, has no such a thing. Like rage is a power source. I believe that you can do stuff with rage. But if you're driven by rage, you cannot do things from the long run. But if you are freeze, you go to the accumulation state, and you just want to protect what is yours. So we go for like this egocentrism that like is just for you and those you love, and you forgot the global community, you forgot those around you, right? So we need to find messages that actually move people through emotions. What I've been trying, it's like making people do the homecoming. So yeah, we are talking a lot about indigenous wisdom, traditional communities, the way they deal with nature. But we are doing us and them, right? It's like actually us too. But we choose live in a concrete box. We choose put like rubber in our feet at the first moment of the day before touch the ground. We choose look to our phones first before look to the sky in the morning. So it's those small choices that drives the behavior that we're gonna have, all the decisions we're gonna take during the day. So you're trying to use content creation to show people that it's possible live with digital technology, but in a way that you don't lose yourself in your connection with nature.
Thanks. Post-traumatic stress disorder to post-traumatic growth. Mm-hmm. And we have Jacob Johns with us, who's been through a fair amount of trauma. What have been your tools to help to move you through into a new state and way of being and thinking?
Yeah, you know, just building off of what you said, last year, in the second year of the project, the Wisdom Keepers delegation, I was down in New Mexico, in Española, New Mexico, for the U.S. Climate Action Network annual meeting, West Coast meeting, and we support local movement spaces. Local indigenous organizers asked me to come to a prayer vigil, and in the morning, far-right fascists showed up with a gun and shot me in the chest with a hollow point bullet. The bullet took my life. I died, and they had to fly me from the helicopter from Española to Albuquerque, and I died. And in the moment of life, that time and space beyond death and life, I had to meet a council of spirits that I had to convince to let me come back into this body. I have a 12-year-old daughter, and it was really important for me to come back and continue to be a father to my child. And you know, they told me it wasn't going to be easy, that it was going to be painful and all of these things, and I had to go through, and I had agreed to all kinds of things, new things that seemed impossible now, but I agreed to it to come back in. And when I did, I had the hollow point bullet went through and it destroyed my insides. It went through my chest, my liver, my pancreas, my spleen, and out my back, and I had two drains in my pancreas and one in my liver for 6 months. But 2 weeks out of the hospital, I made prior commitments on the spirit side. And so I jumped on a plane, I went to Dubai, and going through security in Doha with tubes coming out of your abdomen is a whole nother experience. But while I was in the hospital, a medicine man came to me and would continually come to me and told me that I needed to just stop taking the pain meds. And I was on morphine, I mean, a wide variety of narcotics to get through the pain, and I had, you know, 100 staples in my chest. And he told me I needed to stop taking it and feel the pain for what it was. Mm. It was my body rejuvenating. It was a celebration of healing. And if your mind was able to shift the negative into a positive, you could celebrate that pain as rejuvenation. Wow. And I'm like, can I just get some morphine? Like, like I got shot. Like, this is for real. But I stopped taking the pain meds, and I felt the pain for what it was. And we, you know, raw dogging life is a whole other experience. But you know, as that idea of shifting, you know, I think when we talked about earlier, I was talking a little bit about the apocalypse, and we're being fed these dystopian views of the future, and everything's screwed, and capitalism will win, and the environment will die. That out of destruction, creation is born. Mm-hmm. And as I've traveled around the world with meeting with indigenous people from around the globe, praying at sacred sites around the planet, they all say the same thing, that the new world is waiting for us. It actually already has been created, and it's waiting for us to collectively realize it and walk gracefully together into that new world.
The whole process.
And the idea is right here with us. And my tradition speaks of the fourth world, the fourth world where humanity will come together and understand that we are children in utero here on the planet, and more importantly, that we are the planet itself. And we must use the voice that we have to speak for nature in a way that is logical and separates us from the emotional turmoil of fascist dictators, and more importantly, focuses our mind from the destruction into the creation of a new world, the new world that is right here, being born and blossoming in our hearts.
Mm. Nice.
Jacob, you're a powerful testament to your story. Thank you for not taking the pain meds and for sitting with that pain. And I think a lot of us, the businesses, the policymakers, the activists, the NGOs, we need to learn how to sit with pain. And I'm curious to hear your thoughts, Tim, about how do you help people to sit with that? Because Tim's an interesting example. He was studying Earth system tipping points. He was not doing positive tipping points. And he came across the mechanism basically that is leading to mass scale natural collapses. And I can tell you the trauma that comes from that in the recognition of just how urgent the change is. We have 5 Earth system tipping points that, if they have not already tipped, are on the brink. So Tim, in your life, how have you kind of turned that toxin into a cure?
Well, I think I was very lucky in my early path, because I connected with nature, thanks to my mum, very young. And I found my kind of scientific calling really early, wrestling difficult times aged 18. And I read Jim Lovelock's books on Gaia, the Earth as a living, self-regulating system. And I thought, I knew I wanted to be a scientist, and two things came together. I knew that's what I wanted to study. And if you have the calling as a scientist, especially to study nature and how nature works and how you're part of it, and you're totally dependent on it, and it doesn't depend on you, which is basically us scientists rediscovering what most indigenous wisdoms will tell you. If you grasp that stuff, firstly, you're motivated by a deep-seated optimism, because you just see the wonder in the living world around you, and you go and seek that. My happy place is Dartmoor, by the way, in my native Devon, where I like to fell run, which is a British way of saying just run through the wild landscape, regardless of the tracks or whatever. So to get back to the science story, working on trying to articulate this different worldview to the culturally dominant one, that we're still living in some kind of clockwork machine where outputs are proportional to inputs, and leaders delude themselves that they've got perfect control over this clockwork machine. I was kind of busy seeing this different, larger being, or whatever you want to think of it as, system, of which we are just a small part. And so, yeah, it keeps you awake at night when you see the tipping points, the bad ones that we're collectively triggering in our life support system. It's deeply alarming. But I'm very lucky to have the ability to then take the same thinking and apply it back to us and try to find a way out of trouble that wouldn't be just naive hope, because that just doesn't wash for me, and I hope it probably doesn't wash for many of you, but was actually what a friend of mine coined plausible grounds for hope, or credible hope. So it took quite a bit of searching to take the same mental toolkit and look at us and look at our industries or our technologies or innovation and see that it wasn't a completely hopeless cause. But at the bottom line, if it isn't, from what I said, obvious already, it's apart from doing the technological transformative things I talked about, we're really going to have to re-ask ourselves, growth of what do we want, if anything? Certainly not GDP, possibly some spiritual things, certainly some trees that have been lost. Certainly we need to grow in the transient, those solar panel fields and so on and so forth. But I think what the point is, the deepest tipping point we're going to get to one way or the other, whether it's through crisis or through a progressive agenda, is we're going to end up having to shift the culturally dominant worldview back to the one that Jacob and many other peoples have long held. Mm. And at that point, we might be out of trouble. But I'm blessed because I grew up with that, and I've always felt an anomaly of seeing the world differently to the world that I was presented with.
It's incredible to see how nature grounds us and has the answers. Camilla, did you want to respond?
Yeah, I'm going to add 2 things. One is a phrase that a friend of mine told me. He says, nature is obsessed to spread life, and she will do no matter what. So with this, I would say that nature is also it's not everything beautiful. We can all romanticize our relationship in nature, but it's transformative. It actually makes everything better. But if we are on the way to not let this planet evolve, it's the planet will be okay it's our life that it won't be, right?
Yeah.
And I just want to bring one thing. There's no solution that is beautiful for everyone. Even talking about positive tipping points.
Yeah.
If we choose EVs, we might have mining issues. If we choose focus on youth, we might have problem with the elders, economically speaking. Mm. So, it's not easy make those choices. But if we continue to romanticize the choices, we won't be able to actually have critical thinking to find the solutions that it's best, like, won't be best for everybody. And this is painful and uncomfortable, you know, because no one wanna be canceled, no one wanna be known as someone that make a decision that kills millions of people, but we need to see it with those type of decisions. And as much as we are able to do in a more open and honest way, I think as a society, we can feel the pain together and overcome. But we need to decide right now, otherwise everyone will be actually screwed.
Thank you. We're gonna go to the questions from the audience now. If you haven't asked your question, please do. We have lots of action here happening, so lots of upvoting. So if you see a question you really want to be asked, please let me know through upvoting on the app, slido.com, hashtag positive tipping points. Just to go back, I think Thich Nhat Hanh says, no mud, no lotus. The lotuses cannot live without the mud. And as you say, not every solution is going to be perfect for everyone. And I think sometimes our media frameworks actually delude us and think the black and white thinking is how we should orient. And I just want to go to Solly briefly to ask about information integrity.
Yeah.
And how do we help ensure information integrity in a system where there is too much black and white thinking and we're not willing enough to sit with those uncomfortable realities where not everybody can be optimized for?
Absolutely. So, and also, I got Taggart to come up here as well, so we'll try to get her back up again, the Solutions House dog. The first thing I want to say, and it's so I'm autistic, and one of the things about being autistic is often being confused about what other people think and feel, and not always understanding how you think and feel. And what that's led me to realize recently is I don't believe there is any right way to think or feel about climate change. And I think sometimes we're so desperate to try to convince other people of the way that they should think and feel about climate change without realizing that there is an incredible diversity of mindsets and emotional states amongst human beings. There's an incredible diversity of mindsets and emotional states within one family in terms of how people respond to things. And so if rage motivates you to take action, rage is the best emotional state for you. If grief motivates you to take action, grief is the best. If optimism motivates you to take action, if selfishness motivates you to take action, because actually that's what motivates you. If hope does, if love does, that probably if I was to pick an emotion, and again, this is coming from someone who's autistic, who struggles sometimes to categorize these, probably the only emotion which I would suggest might be one you might want to work on if you're experiencing it is numbness. That numbness is probably the emotion that just, I don't want to think about it, I don't want to look at it, I've not got anything. And so I think one of the things which it would be great to do when we're thinking about collectively triggering positive tipping points is not to somehow boundary how people are allowed to think about and feel about sustainability. And I am monumentally optimistic and positive about it and have been for my whole career. And one of the reasons why I'm optimistic and positive about it is because I don't expect the world to validate me. I don't expect that my efforts, that the entire planet is going to turn around and show me that my efforts have worked. I do it because it's the right thing to do. And doing the right thing to do, it works. And I think that
what we need to see, so all this afternoon, we have Hollywood in here. So their next session is from a lot of the Hollywood studios, and we have the social media companies, and we have Hollywood directors, and Bollywood and Nollywood coming in. And they are really eager to try to tell a new story about climate change. And what we're trying to, and they're trying to work out, what is the story? What's the story we have to tell about climate change that's going to change everything? And the sad thing, answer to them is, there isn't one. There's 500, there's 1,000, because the stories that we tell to generate those tipping points need to be as reflective of the diversity of emotional states of how people come to them. And so I think that that's one of the things which very, very much looking for. And the disinformation point within that is that disinformation often tries to, because disinformation isn't actually that powerful. People talk about information being powerful. It's actually not. Framed information is powerful. Whether you tell someone that this is a piece of information about climate change, which means climate change isn't true and you're being exploited. Or this piece of technology doesn't work and you're being ripped off. Or this community is, and that's, the information makes no difference. It's how it's framed, not least because you can take one piece of information and frame it multiple different ways. And I think one of the things which we're looking for in how we review disinformation is to not be obsessed with the information itself, but to go, why is someone trying to disinform? What is the frame that they're using to disinform? And can we try to affect that frame? Because what's happening a lot at the moment is fact-checking, which has been fact-checked to show it makes absolutely no bloody difference. Because the actual fact wasn't the thing that was affecting people, it was the frame around it. And so being able to get other voices, other frames out in there, being able to tell people you don't have to be scared of this, or you don't have to feel angry about this piece of information, that's much, much, much more important than just removing the disinformation itself. Because it's as if we've decided that the disinformation is the problem rather than the disinformers and why they're doing it. And going, actually, the information isn't the problem. It's the motivation of the people who are putting it out there, and that's what needs to be tackled rather than the information itself.
Strong message of critical thinking that's needed there from Sally, and I think that's something for us to cultivate in ourselves, but also with our children, to help them to navigate this complex digital world. Our top question is going to go to Jacob. It's, what is an example of embedding Indigenous knowledge in climate policy? And what are the lessons that you've learned in the process of doing that?
Yeah, we live in this world, this capitalistic, consumeristic world where we are separate from nature. And one of the simplest things, I think, is for us to reconnect to the truth that we are all connected. And that the beat of our hearts, the energy moving yours and moving mine, is the same energy. And there's a spiritual practice that we do traditionally where we sit facing the sun. As the sun arises, we envision sunlight filling in our bodies, breathing in light. As we exhale, we breathe out the darkness, the stress, all of the things, until our bodies dissolve and then we're left with just one sphere of consciousness. And where our heads used to be becomes the North Pole. And where our base of our spines used to be becomes the South Pole. And where our hearts are connected to the center of the planet. Mm-hmm. And we must realize that we are the planet and that we can shift change. So just as the Earth absorbs light from the sun to warm it, just like you did with your body, you can focus on the core of your heart and realize that the same light, the same heat, the same energy that we are absorbing from outside sources is actually contained inside of us. And more importantly, that once we link our hearts to the center of the planet, we can broadcast new energy from all of our hearts from the center of the planet simultaneously. And this practice of going around and realigning yourself with the truth, realigning yourself with the mother, realigning yourself with the truth of this physical reality, it's transcendent. And I, you know, want to really find ways to do this in different places. And I think that's the separation. It's this idea that we can commodify ourselves in order to have more material things over others.
The idea of us to reconnect, especially changing the hearts and minds of decision makers who are in these meetings all this week as we get into COP and all those people behind closed doors during COP, we want to be able to broadcast energy. And we want to be able to really, really exude the energy, the world that we need, the truly world that we desire, and more importantly, the world that we deserve. And it's a reminding of ourselves that the future is within grasp, it's already been created, and it's waiting for us. And this, I think, is really, really important. And it, you know, I think it comes to the baseline of all of the Indigenous wisdom keepers that we work with around the globe, representing every single bioregion on the planet, that we are nature.
Yeah.
And we must remind humanity that we are animals here on this planet, and more importantly, that we are siblings. We are sisters. We are brothers. And we must take care of our family. And this is something that it seems foreign to people. I mean, I can exploit you, I can extract you, I can trade one community's health for another. But the truth is, we can move forward, we can broadcast, and more importantly, that we have that common denominator, and opening our hearts to connection is important.
So it's not just about sitting with fear, it's reminding ourselves. And I will be certainly taking that back with me as one of the intentions for the years ahead as we are coming together in collective action. I'd like to ask this next question to Camilla. The younger generation is a component of the collective tipping point. What do we do to build optimism when they feel anxiety?
Well, I'm going to share my personal practice here because it's the only thing I can do. I do 5 things every day. I walk barefoot first thing. I look to the sky before I look to my phone every day. I have a cold shower every day. Yeah. And I take care of my plants in my room and I pray every day. Yeah. These 5 things keeps me grounded and aligned with the why I'm doing what I'm doing. And when the anxiety came, like I realized that fight for nature is our spiritual awakening. Mm-hmm. Believing you in God or not is a spiritual path. Because at the moment you can feel that you are united, that you are part of something that is bigger than you, has no anxiety that can continue growing inside of you. The anxiety comes from the fear of not having that feeling again. It's not that you don't reach the thing, it's that you're fearing like losing, right? So sometimes I don't have optimism. Sometimes I'm full of rage. Mm-hmm. But every day I need to remind me that I don't want to be building a future in the long run based on rage. Because relationship is not scalable. Trust is not scalable. It's a daily work. And if we say that we're going to do business that are fair and just, but we're going to do in scale without looking people in the eye, without sitting with discomfort, it's just not possible. It's just not possible. I remember like I was reading bookstores and I would say like our relationship was based, like we took decisions, we buy stuff in the past, looking people in the eyes, shaking hands. We outsource the trust of our relationships to institutions. And some point is right, is what we need as a global community of 8 billion people. But to do it right, it has to be personal. If we outsource everything to institutionalize, the anxiety will be there because we are already losing. But if we be able to bring back to the relationship part, to the personal side, we might find hope in each other every day. See it with anxiety, but we keep going.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, beautiful, good.
Good reflections.
Right action is a powerful motivator of change, and I think that your comments really, really reflect that. And I think the point on we can't all be that exponential force. Sometimes local action, small-scale action is needed, but we need to remember that that's our pebble, right? And if we throw that pebble in a way that's harmonized with others, we can actually bring those positive tipping points together. We have one final question, Tim. I'm going to orient this to you. And it is, how can we better embed traditional knowledge and collective worldviews in our workplace and our mainstream cultures?
Great question. And I'm glad that one came up, because I wanted to build on what Jacob said. Because for me, rights of nature, stop ecocide, exclamation mark. Where's that come from? That's come from the brave fight of indigenous activists to see a worldview we desperately need to get back to take prominence, that we have to give nature the legal status and rights it deserves as our life support system to battle the insanity of neoliberal capitalism that's destroying it. So can we do that? Can we manifest that in our lives or in our companies? I don't see why not. I mean, we can choose to be part of that movement. I think it would be interesting, if it hasn't already happened, to see businesses that commit to be part of rights of nature or stop ecocide, whatever flavor you like. I can tell you for sure the number of legal cases on rights of nature is growing exponentially in those kind of nice tipping dynamics we see across other domains. And that for me is perhaps one of the brightest lights of hope.
Thank you.
I'm going to apologize that if you see me disappear, it's to go and express my outrage and optimism on Christiana's live version of the podcast that's going to start recording in about 30 minutes. So I shall cycle as hard as I can to maybe share some of what we've said today.
Thank you, and you're welcome to go. Thank you for that. Just on this question, the World Economic Forum took a bold action on this in 2023. We wrote a report called Embedding Indigenous Knowledge into the Conservation and Restoration of Landscapes, and it targets investors and financiers. So the audience for the report is business, but it's written in the voice of the indigenous. And it's been really remarkable. It was probably one of the most ambitious and challenging reports to write. But what was incredible is when it landed, there was no, everyone was supportive of it. The indigenous peoples who felt their voices represented in the message, and the investors who recognized the value of indigenous wisdom, not in partnering with, but in co-leading with. So if that's something that you'd be interested to have a look at coming out of this panel, we'd encourage that. I'd like to turn to Jacob to do the closing for us. He's going to share a Hopi prayer, and we're very grateful to you for helping us to close the space, but also to take the energy of this panel into this week for everybody, and for us all to be those ambassadors of positive tipping points with our little pebbles as we move forward into this week. Thank you, Jacob.
Okay, we're here. Come on, quite it, Emma. I just wanted to say too that, you know, despite the negativity that we're bombarded by and the pessimistic versions of the future that they're trying to feed us, that the future itself is undefined, and it's us who define that future. Is that right? Oh, okay. Hey!
yo. Right, more right, more right, nay. Oi, hi, 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 ow, ow.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the session. Remember to be the lotus in the mud. And when you see the wet mud, to sit with it, to see it, not to take the drugs, and to allow the lotuses to flower.